a lot of people's wondering, what is the blues? I hear a lot of people saying the blues, but I'm gonna tell you what the blues is.
This is the story of an unlikely love affair that was awakened, innocently enough, in the drabness of 50s Britain, but by the 70s had blossomed into a global passion. From its origins as a secret society, all the way to the international stage, this is what happened when Britain got the blues. '50s Britain. A bombed-out country marked by austerity, demob suits, and dreams of better times to come. A generation of post-war kids found itself stranded in the dust-covered landscape of national reconstruction.
Yeah, it was great. Like, when the hell are we going to get out of here? You know, I thought we won. You know, and bloody awful, and you couldn't get any sweets either. No, we were on rationing, baby. Big time.
So there was no colour whatsoever in Britain. Glasgow didn't exist. There was just a sort of grey wash. You didn't see, kept bumping into things because you couldn't see anything. Dark at 4 o'clock, Ovaltine, all of that stuff.
There was nowhere for young people to go. There was nothing specifically for young people. Everything was run by pretty strict rules, regulations by the establishment. They were very depressing days.
Musically, the antidote was obvious. Dance bands and crooners provided all the entertainment the country could consume in its dogged determination to make whoopee. But not everyone sought solace in the two-step.
Britain, by about 1950, 53, 54, was crying out for alternative music. You didn't get, the first rock and roll wasn't about until about sort of 55, 56 really, was it, you see? Before that, it was gutless music.
The guts of American rock and roll spilled out across Britain in 1957, creating the teenage phenomenon. But 2 years later, the emotional and musical rescue it offered prematurely stalled. The business had moved in and the greats had shipped out, leaving Britain at the mercy of Tin Pan Alley copyists.
Elvis went into the army, Jerry Lee Lewis ruined his career by marrying his 12-year-old first cousin while still married to someone else. Chuck Berry crossed over the border and did various borderline activities. And Little Richard went into gospel. Rock and roll lost its, well, I suppose really lost its excitement.
Watered down trash, a lot of it, wasn't it? You know, like Moon in June and Lipstick on Your Collar and all these, Lipstick on Your Collar, you know, horrible.
Traveling life.
Rock and roll's early adopters now needed a new drug. They discovered the power, depth, and authenticity they craved in a music they hadn't heard before, the very basis of rock and roll, black folk music from the American South, the blues.
The intensity and the... it's so direct. You know, I hadn't experienced anything like that since the first time I heard Little Richard.
And my mojo. Just don't worry on you.
It bypasses a lot of cultural education. You didn't need any information with the blues, it just went.
I wanna love you so bad.
It can be to dance for, it can to get drunk for it, to fuck by it, you name it.
I'm going down in blues and to get me a mojo.
When it's well put and well performed, it's infectious, and it doesn't, you don't need to know even what it is. You go, that's how people get
get hooked.
I'm gonna have all you women's wretched mind.
I think that once, you know, once you get the bug, it's really, really hard to get rid of it.
Catching the bug was one thing, but feeding it was another. Specialist shops selling imported American recordings began to appear, many of them, mysteriously, in what became known as the Thames Delta, Britain's distant echo of the American South. Future British blues artists Tony McPhee, Dave Kelly, and his sister Joanne Kelly haunted the Swing Shop in Streatham.
When you get home, baby, please write me if you're sure mine.
That was one thing that really got to me, that so many people were interested more in how rare this thing was, this 78 was, rather than what was on it. You know.
Please write me if you're sure mine.
That's where I got all my John Lee Hooker and Howling Wolf on Crown, which is 1940s stuff, Wolf stuff for Sun. And Joanne, myself, Tony McPhee, used to hang around the Swing Shop waiting for another consignment to come in and elbow each other out of the way.
There was a shop in what is now Chinatown in Soho, but at that time it was a street of shops selling valves and ex-army spares. You'd see, I mean, you know, you have this picture of sort of men in long raincoats wandering around Soho. Well, these were men in long raincoats who'd be standing looking in the window at cathode ray tubes and valves and diodes. And on a Saturday, in the basement of one of these shops, the guy started importing records.
There was something very attractive about the fact that large numbers, huge numbers of people wanted to listen to Bill Haley and Tommy Steele, but that we wanted to listen to Howling Wolf and Little Walter.
Jelly Roll Morton and Lightning Slim. I mean, extraordinary names too. I mean, how crazy is that, you know? Howling Wolf. What is a howling wolf when you live in Surbiton?
You thought, my God, I mean, how can anybody be called Muddy Waters, you know, or Howling Wolf, or Bo Diddley? Where the hell did these names, or Leadbelly, where did these names come from? What is this, you know? It was a feel.